It's no secret. There's something lurking out there in the forest all around the world. Now, if you've seen it, I want to hear about it, and so does everyone else. Put your experience into an email and send it on in to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. Then I'll get it narrated, and I'll put it up here for everyone to enjoy. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Well, tonight we've got a return guest. Now, Dee has written us before about her encounters in Missouri, and if you've missed the other encounters that Dee has sent in, I'll put links up at the end of this video, as well as in the video description below. Now, Dee has had a lot of repeat encounters with an entire family of Bigfoot out there on her land. There's a mischievous juvenile that she calls Junior, and then there's a big one she calls Mo, and there's Grandma and a few others. So tonight, yeah, she's sending in a few more. So get your snackage ready, because I'm getting ready to get started with Dee's encounters right now. Hey there, Nance. Dee here. I hope everything is going well with you and the Sasquad. I had given a few details of these true accounts to the late Brenton Salwin over the phone before his death in 2019, and he said, "We need to get that story out there for people to hear. Promise me you'll share that egg story, because it's unusual and terribly scary, too." And so I promised him, and I even alluded to it once while taping, but he changed the subject. Later, he told me he wanted to devote a whole show to it. That was a good call, because at the time, I was too geared up. I was nervously babbling. My teeth were chattering like my joints had been sprayed with WD-40. So please run this series past the Sasquatch, huh, Nance? The Deviled Egg Incident, Part 1. These encounters took place a few miles from my home to the west of my property in rural west central Missouri. They happened between 2014 to 2016. I think the main event took place a few days after Independence Day in 2015. I recall the day Mom and I had found ourselves essentially out of a church home. You see, this sometimes happens with very small rural churches. It becomes very hard for a handful of elderly folks to maintain and provide for keeping the lights on and such. We were sad when our church at a place that I'll call Flowers closed its doors. My mother's uncle had ridden a horse to preach there as a young man in the early 1920s. Eventually, he got a used car and courted the daylights out of my great-aunt-to-be. He even drove her to Kansas City to show her the tall buildings and bought her lunch from a lunch wagon. Oh, yeah, that was high finance. But times were simpler then. Now, some of you may have gone to a little clapboard church as a child, or visited one just like it. There are several such historic churches in my area, and many of them have white clapboard over their log frames. They've endured everything from Civil War renegades to making way for the newfangled Rock Island Railroad tracks. Sadly, the only thing the church at Flowers couldn't survive was a lack of attendance. There was another congregation nearby, and it had a historic church building, too. I will call this town Meadowville. By God's grace, the congregation survived when fire destroyed their church building. It's truly amazing to see how they rebuilt on this site, surrounded by fertile cornfields. The people are not numerous, but they make up for it with heart, the real kind of faith that perseveres. Mom and I were made to feel right at home, right among the congregation at Meadowville. The pastor's wife said, "This is your home," as she gave us a quick tour of their beautiful new church building. No one ever said anything about our being from a different faith denomination. They just loved on us, and we felt accepted like family. This church, though, is the site of my story. Now, if you have been listening to my other goings-on with the local Bigfoot troop led by Mo, you may recall that I have related that the males have a propensity to mark over everything that has our scent, including our car door handles. And I don't mean that they mark with a Sharpie. My poor mother kept wet wipes in the car just to wipe off her hands. "That rotten rear-ended son of a perdition," she would say, speaking of the loathsome young Bigfoot male, Junior. Now, it's a nasty thing to grab a wet, stinky car door handle at 3 a.m. when you're just trying to drive into work. "What?" I'd ask her sarcastically. "You mean you don't like wearing a musk at dusk to work?" So there we were, laughing about the elephant in the room again, just to mask the fear that we endured constantly. Sure, you don't see the Sasquatch here daily, but we live daily with the knowledge that they could be hiding, watching, or creeping through at any time. They are nomadic, and we have seen them every month of the calendar. And Brenton was right. Your average animal? They just don't cast that much fear. He called them corrupted flesh, implying they are half human and half demonic. Now, what do I think? Ask me 3 different days, and I may give you 3 different answers. I have pondered this question for decades, and I have argued the validity of each assumption. I am also a skeptic to the bone that cannot deny proof. If you wish to see one, well, it will likely rattle everything you thought you knew about the world around you. I have asked God what these things are. I have been so terrified that my bladder walls have contracted hard enough to make the blood vessels break down in my bladder. A few times, I had to be treated for adrenal exhaustion, something that can kill you. My doctor stroked my head and asked me, "Dee, what is this fear that is threatening your life?" I simply could not bring myself to tell her that I live on the Sasquatch's land and that they may have killed the prior tenant. The Deviled Egg Incident, Part 2. You know, I think the creatures were both curious and outraged because our schedules and destinations had changed when we changed churches. Mom also began working 4 10-hour days, and this may have been interfering with their hunts, and they had become terribly restless. I think some young males were looking at Mo with an eye to usurp his authority. We noticed changes in their hunting patterns and often saw deer running along the road in front of our home. The deer were spooked, and we now saw more than just their confused tracks. Broken deer legs lay in our yard, and deer ran everywhere except into our woods. They even would desperately get entangled up in the fencing. Deer were seeking us out when we were directly out front, where there was little cover. It was like we were a safe haven. And instead of leaving for church on Sunday mornings, we now began leaving home Sunday nights. It took nerve getting out of the car. We were still easily within the Bigfoot's range, considering the ranges of other predators. I mean, it's nothing for a bobcat to cover 45 square miles. Look it up sometime. It's really astonishing. Now, old Mrs. Peters was caretaker for the church at Meadowville and had faithfully filled this position for decades. She proudly told me that she kept a strict schedule. My theory is Sasquatch like predictability. I have seen them when I am off my schedule, and having lived in the Lower East Side, I know that criminals also like to study the predictability of their victims. Many people pride themselves on their routines, and criminals know it. Believe me, these creatures know our comings and goings. They knew Mom would be carrying her lunch at 3 a.m. through the week. But I digress. Mrs. Peters was concerned that others carry on in her stead in caring for the church sanitation. She had health issues, so several folks pitched in to help. Now, this changed our schedule, and it also meant various people were coming and going to the church at all hours, something people hadn't done since they rebuilt after the fire years earlier. The Deviled Egg Incident, Part 3. I visited with Joe, an older gentleman at church, who told me through tears that he had seen the devil himself looking into his bedroom window at him. I asked Joe to describe him to me, and he said, "Huge, tall, broad-shouldered, covered with black hair, deep-set red eyes and a heavy brow, a wide, flattened nose, but not a muzzle, a peaked head, but no visible ears. He was lying in bed, taking his oxygen treatment, and looked up to see this frightening thing bent down, looking in with an evil grin." Now, Joe had been military trained, and he couldn't have been more precise in his description. By the time he'd finished, I was sure his hairy voyeur was a Bigfoot, and probably Mo, and I told him so. I shared some details about Mo with him, and he believed me, but he asked me how I knew. So I confessed that we were seeing Mo, too. He told me how terrified their shepherd mix was of it, she, who would fearlessly tackle anything. He spoke of all the years that he'd been fishing, but never had he seen the likes of Mo. My sharing about Mo was an important gift to him, and he was so grateful to not feel crazy. I told him to put up some curtains and let the dog in before nightfall. Oh, and be sure to lock the doors, because they know how to turn doorknobs. He was curious when I said they. Well, because there's a breeding population here. Now, I said that with a very gentle expression in order to keep him calm, as he had long been a heart patient. But, oh man, I shuddered all the way home afterward. This stuff sure puts a different spin on Honey, I'm Home. The Deviled Egg Incident, Part 4. Eventually, it was our turn to sweep up at church, carry out trash and so forth in late spring, a practice that we had carried out for quite a while. Now, this actually afforded me a chance at a somewhat normal life, for at least part of the day. It had gotten so scary at home with Junior, launching sticks and stones or hedge apples at us, or shoving us and destroying our gardens. He was tearing down our clothesline and eating our pets. Well, we were at church one Saturday afternoon when I stepped out the only back door to beat a rug. But instead, I saw what I first thought was an unusual log lying in the grass about 15 feet away. More than a yard long, it extended from the dense, brushy edges of a cornfield, passed under a gap in the fence separating them, and into the mowed church lawn. Now, part of my job was to pick up fallen sticks, so I looked up at the fence row trees, trying to figure out where this had come from. Near my end of the log, there was a rabbit nibbling the grass. As I looked on, the rabbit hopped closer to the log, which was actually a hairy brown Bigfoot arm. My jaw dropped as I saw the enormous hand with the palm facing up suddenly rise up out of the grass and take a swipe at the rabbit, which was only just a tad out of its reach. The motion of the hand was so smooth, so nimble, it made me think of spiders' legs. The grasp was light and quick. Now, the brain behind it jockeyed for a second opportunity as the rabbit froze in place. But that's when I stepped up onto the deck and leaned out around the northwest corner of the building to watch from a higher vantage point. From there, I could clearly see the outstretched hairy arm and open, hairless palm on the ground. But the rabbit then saw me and left the area. I looked for any other part of the hulking hunter in the grass, but the arm was absolutely all I could see. The hair was the same shade of brown as Junior's. How glad I was that I didn't walk closer and try to pick up that log. I tell you, they are truly masters of camouflage. There were more things that needed doing outdoors that afternoon, like trimming bushes. But I decided to wait until there were more people around. I got my lily white indoors and fast. The Deviled Egg Incident, Part 5. Another time, I decided to get a rag and wash off a Rubbermaid bench out on the deck, and I used a knife to dig between the deck boards. The following Sunday night, we found the deck, the steps, and the bench had all been scratched up very deeply. The spacing between the scratches was very wide. There was a lingering stench around the deck's double doors, too. We have no area bears, and this looked like what we had been finding at home. As I listened to people questioning the source of this damage, it was painful to keep it to myself. I knew what was responsible, because the Bigfoot handle everything I touch. Eventually, I swallowed hard and I told the pastor. I pulled up a snow track photo I had taken on Mom's phone. Handing it to him, I said, "What do you make of this?" He was speechless at first. Then he said, "If you say you've seen it, I believe you." I mean, here, these people had treated us like family, and it's like now they were paying the price. I felt like I had carried a plague, an infestation of gigantic, mutant, killer fleas, and I had unleashed them now on my new friends. Then I realized that the Bigfoot may have already been acquainted with these people sent by reason of their trash. When we took the church's trash home to our dumpster, it must have connected the dots for these ever-hungry creatures, maybe opening new avenues for their infamy. There was a huge, newly cut tree stump out on the church property, which we used as tag base for the kids' games during the daytime. People were shocked when we found it all clawed over by something very powerful. Very little bark was left on it. It was fearfully amazing, and even the old men there were left scratching their heads, except for Joe, who eyed me coolly from the back row. The Deviled Egg Incident, Part 6. July rolled around, and the church decided to host an Independence Day fireworks display. They had invited the whole community to come to enjoy free bluegrass music, food, fireworks, and fellowship. It was going to be a regular country outdoor shindig, complete with fireworks. A couple of us entered the abandoned Edwardian parsonage house to look for totes full of holiday decorations. Just before the shindig, a farmer delivered over 20 dozen eggs to the church to be deviled. Of course, we all held our breath as each person secretly hoped that someone else would volunteer to cook, shell, and prepare them all. Well, until the two of us finally said, "Oh, well, why not?" Thus, we had an appointment with destiny involving the plentiful fruit of foul fannies. The weather turned off unusually cool for July, and I have long observed that the Bigfoot double their foraging during cooler temperatures. Mom and I got lunch, and we went to the church and found everything we needed to devil the veritable plethora of eggs. The day heated up, as did the church kitchen and the dining hall, which had several huge windows for natural light. We didn't wish to stink up the whole building with the eggs, so I closed some inner doors, and Mom opened out the double doors onto the deck. You know, very few people will pass up a deviled egg. Come to think of it, neither will the king of the forest. He'll take his sunny side, souffled, fried, scrambled, or just plain raw. That big howler loves the incredible edible egg. Oh, and make his plural eggs. And throw in the whole hen house, too, while you're at it. Soon, my mother and I had eggs and eggshells in gobs and heaps. Everyone had brought their egg trays there, so we worked toward getting one refrigerator packed with untold numbers of deviled eggs. We had been touching up the building in between boiling and cooling sessions, too. So we were wearing down. I got those exterior doors locked up, and that's when my mother dried her hands, grabbed her purse, and announced, "I have to run into town. I forgot that I said I was going to make a couple of big jello cakes." And I said, "As much as I love them, you may have to rethink that. They'll take up space in the refrigerator." But she hopped right into her car and left me up to my neck in eggshells. A small black neighborhood dog had slipped inside when Mom left. Now this cur was old as the hills and a very determined watchdog, too. Everyone called her Chloe, and by all accounts, she always made sure to be indoors when it got dark outside. I flipped on a light in the kitchen as she curled up on a carpet by the double front doors. I continued making headway on the exceptional mess and pondered what effect that many eggshells would have on the garbage disposal. Trash wasn't going to be picked up soon, and I needed to dump them somewhere. Oh my gosh, was that an owl? Is that an owl I hear? And I felt sick when I heard that familiar call. Now, barn owls are common around here, but this one, he sounded deeper than Tennessee Ernie Ford. I kept my back toward the big windows, and I began double-sacking the eggshells with a fury. Just then, another pathetic owl call. I then heard a small thud at the front doors. I spun around at the kitchen sink and saw Chloe backing away from the front doors until her rear smacked up against the interior glass doors that led into the dining hall. From the kitchen, I turned at another sound like gravel showering down over the roof. I looked to my right again, and I saw Chloe with her back bristling, struggling to get into where I was. I wanted to turn on the deck lights that were to my left, but in order to do that, I would have to pass close to those big glass double-deck doors. That's what I was deciding to do when a pair of large, round eyes glinted at me from the bottom of the deck rails. As I watched, these eyes began to rise steadily beyond the railing on the deck and then stopped. This thing was massive. This creature's eyes met mine. Then it turned away, and I couldn't see it at all. All I could hear was Chloe's desperate scratching on the base of the interior doors to my right and the hum of the refrigerator behind me. Another call from an owl from hell. This time, it came from the lightweight door beside the refrigerator I was standing in front of. This was not one of their loud calls, yet it was about a yard from me, and the blast rattled the door and my innards. I knew if they were calling back and forth, they were communicating their positions with others. The next thing that happened made my blood run cold. I spun around and faced the door, which faced west, and I listened as the Bigfoot began sniffing all around the edges of the door, loud, long breaths that each ended in quick blasts as it exhaled. These were mighty big lungs that probably held as much air as the black Percheron workhorses I saw at the fair. I cannot find words to explain my horror when the doorknob began to rattle. It was trying to open the door. I flipped off the overhead lights, but realized that while it kept me from being light up on display for them, I would have to give my eyes time to adjust, or I'd never be able to navigate through a dark dining hall filled with tables and chairs. I turned again to face the exterior door, and I thought, I'm not going down without a fight. I shoved the nearest table across the door and heard a disgusted sigh come from the other side. Chloe was now curled up as small as she could make herself, lying against the double glass doors that closed my way out of the dining hall. Silence. Then I saw a smaller creature break ranks and stroll casually in front of a large window on the eastern side of the church, soon followed by an immense shower of gravel on the church roof. My eyes had adjusted by then, so dashing over beside the stove, I assembled the baddest knives we had into a towel. Now, they would be useless against the tribe, but they made me feel better. There were at least 4 imposter owls that went off all at once now, and I reacted by crouching behind the serving counter in fear. Believe me, I was praying like my life depended on it. From the sound of it, there was one at every exterior door, with the alpha and the youngest at each side of the deck to my left. There was a long period of perfect, eerie silence, broken only by a couple of words blurted out by a youngster at the northeast corner and the whoosh-whoosh of my heart pounding. I would have almost given them the eggs just to make them go away. I crawled over beside the double exterior deck doors, rose up to my knees, and hit the switch for the deck lights. There was a sudden flurry of heavy footfalls away from the deck, so I crawled back behind the kitchen serving counter to be close to my knives. There began another gravel shower on the roof, and I worried if they might toss the deck furniture through the huge glass windows. Silence came suddenly, followed by a brief hoot from 4 individuals in the darkness. These were all brief, but very close, like their lips could be touching the building. I'd had it. I am not dying over some devil eggs, I thought, and I shuddered. I grabbled my bundle of knives, and I crawled between the tables and chairs until I reached the glass doors where Chloe lay shaking. I turned the handle and pushed against one of the doors, and then I realized she needed to move before I could get out of the dining hall. I shoved and tapped and called until she got up and then went back to trying to get in with me. When I crawled through the doors and onto the carpet, she wriggled past me and then immediately did a reversal and ended up out in front of me, causing me to drop my knives. I went to the light panels by the front doors just as one of the creatures shook the front door handles. That's when I began turning on the floodlights all along the front length of the church. Just then, I saw the glass on the front door filled up with a dark, shaggy figure, and the door handle was attempting to turn. Chloe shrank back behind me into the hallway that led to the women's restroom. My heart sinking, I grasped a knife and I plunged myself toward the door because beside it was the main light panel. I laid my all onto it, flipping on floodlights across the whole front length of the east side of the church. The creature gave a disgusted low moan and moved away from the door, to my great relief. I began making plans to barricade myself into the women's restroom using tubs of 4th of July decor in the spare shower there, which was tile and marble. Okay, me, check. Dog, check. Knives, check. Mom, no. Oh, God, what on earth was taking her so long? And I had left my cell phone in the car. As I knelt in the darkened restroom doorway, I listened for the sound of her car returning. And after an excruciating length of time spent praying, there came her familiar voice from the front doors. There she stood, fumbling for the key, in the exact same spot that thing had just stood, trying the door handle. She looked surprised as I flung open the door holding a knife and dragged her inside, and then had the door locked up behind her before you could say Jack Sprat. Because what I saw was that same stupid juvenile strolling right up behind her as I dragged her in the door. It saw me open the door, and it walked off to Mom's right, and may or may not have kept going. I had shut the door practically in its face. Mom did not know it was behind her. She was babbling about my going out to the car to get her cake mixes and how she ran into people she knew in the store and why was I acting so strange? Just then, a shower of gravel rained down on top of the roof again. I hissed, "They want the eggs!" She said, "Who?" And I said, "Who do you think? The Jackson 5?" A roar arose from the far southwest door, and we both just about wet our pants, knowing that the men had been working on the sound system there, and they may not have locked that door. I slipped down the hall, crossed the vestibule, and peered across the dark sanctuary to the old wooden door, which a shaft of light illuminated from an east window. I watched the knob turning, and it gave a shudder too. Only the door was blocked by huge and heavy sound equipment that was braced against the stage and a piano. I returned to the lady's room, and I asked Mom to get her cell phone out, and she said, "It's in my purse, and my purse is in the car." I took her car key, and I locked her car by remote. I hoped that they wouldn't turn on the car in anger when it blinked and honked, and they didn't. We took the dog into the spare lady's shower, and we barricaded the bathroom door with everything we had on hand. From there, we endured an hour of hellish screaming until someone nearby, maybe Joe, fired off 2 rounds from a shotgun. After that, there was silence. Early the next morning, we heard whistling. It was the happy whistles of our pastor. I don't recall what he was whistling, but it sounded like Amazing Grace to me. We crept out of the bathroom, and he said, "You girls sure got up here early today." As we climbed into the car, he asked, "How on earth did all that gravel get on the roof?" We replied, "Can we talk about it later? It was a rough night." He looked concerned and said, "Sure." He had a crew of men on the way to set up tables, and this was not the last of the sightings nearby. I don't know how Mo and his troop were going to like the fireworks to come. Oh well. Love, D. Wow, thanks again, Dee, for sending in more of these encounters. And it sounds like you have more. If you do, by all means, you know we want to hear them. I can tell you took a lot of time to write these out, and I really appreciate that. And I know the Sasquatch appreciates it as well. I know everyone listening has enjoyed tonight's encounter. And I think you're all also going to like what's coming up the rest of this week. Of course, there's going to be the marathon for Halloween. Actually, it looks like there's going to be a couple different marathons. Now, one is set up to be just fiction stories that people have sent in. And I'll tell you which one that is, because I know there are a lot of you who think that Bigfoot and fiction should never be uttered in the same sentence. And that's okay. I'll let you know so you can skip that one, okay? No tears. Next, I'm putting together a marathon of true Bigfoot encounters that people have sent in. And it looks like I'm going to have enough for maybe another hour or more of other stories. Like, some might be scary, and some might be about other cryptids that they've seen. Anyway, I'll make it clear in the video descriptions for each one which is which, so you can pick and choose which ones to watch and which ones you want to skip. But I do hope you give them all a listen. Beyond that, I have something that, well, I really can't call it an interview. I think it's more accurate to say I just had a phone call with another Bigfoot YouTuber, and we shot the breeze for an hour and a half, 2 hours, and I just happened to have the record button on. So stay tuned. You'll find out who it is this weekend, and you can listen to us just, you know, chew some cud for quite a while. We talk everything from snackage to pets to Bigfoot conventions and more. So keep watching for all the treats that I'll be handing out all the rest of this week and this weekend. Until then, my beloved Sasquatch, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. And if someone tries to tell you different, you send them on to me. Thanks for listening, everyone. Have a great night. Admit it, you know you want more Bigfoot. Hit that subscribe button and hit the ring bell to get notified when the new Bigfoot comes out.